good evening. Our subject matter tonight is, do I need the church? A lot of people today will be telling you that, well, I don't need the church to go to heaven. I don't have to be a part of the church. I can just stay at home and love God and everything's okay. But is that really a true statement? What does the Bible say about our need for the church, the gathering, a place of gathering? Is the church really necessary for one to go to heaven, for one to live an overcoming life? God tells us in His Word that the days prior to the coming of the Lord will be times of great pressure, and surely we live in those times today. These days will be very similar to the days of Noah, where violence and immorality abounded. There'll be days similar to the days of Lot, marked by perversion of every sort. There'll be days characterized by every sort of evil thing. They'll be characterized by tremendous deception and a great departing from the faith. And my friend, if ever there was a day that this has been seen, it's the day in which we live. I guess if there's one word that could be used to describe the days preceding the coming of our Lord, it would have to be the word deception. Jesus, in His own discourse concerning the second coming, warns us of this time and time again. Matthew 24:4, He says, "Take heed that no man deceive you." In verse 24, He tells us that many false ministries will arise and use great signs and wonders, and they'll deceive, and there'll be great deception. If possible, they would even deceive the very elect. Now, I know this sounds like a gloomy picture, yet the people of God who are walking in the ways of the Lord do not need to be fearful. It's those who are placating the world system that need to worry. Those walking on the fence need to be worried. Joel refers to the day of the Lord as the great and terrible day of the Lord in Joel 2:31. He refers to it as a day of darkness and gloominess, a day of clouds and of thick darkness in Joel 2:2. Yet he also sees it as a day that is like the morning spread upon the mountains in Joel 2:2. How can the day of the Lord be both dreadful and great at the same time? It's because it is a day of wrath and vengeance upon the wickedness of the earth, but a day of preservation and salvation for the people of God. Even though wickedness will abound and come in like a flood, we know that our God is going to raise up a standard against all this evil. Isaiah chapter 11 and Isaiah 4:2 talks about the branch of the Lord, and we're going to look at that. What is the branch? Who is the branch? In that day, the branch of the Lord will be beautiful and glorious, and the fruit of the land will be the pride and glory of the survivors in Israel. Those who are left in Zion, who remain in Jerusalem, will be called holy. All who are recorded among the living in Jerusalem. And the Lord will wash away the filth of the women and daughters of Zion. He will cleanse the bloodstains from Jerusalem by a spirit of judgment and a spirit of fire. Notice both of these are spirits. Judgment is a spirit and fire is a spirit. Isaiah 4, 5, and 6. Then the Lord will create over all of Mount Zion and over those who assemble there a cloud of smoke by day and a glow of flaming fire by night. Over all the glory will be a canopy. It will be a shelter and a shade from the heat of the day, and a refuge and a hiding place from the storm and rain. Isaiah 11:1, "And there shall come forth a rod," listen to that, "and out of the stem of Jesse a branch shall grow forth out of his roots." What are these things? What do they mean? Well, "there shall come forth a rod." The rod is Jesus. "Out of the stem of Jesse," that's David, "and a branch shall grow out of its roots." The branch is you and I, the church, the body of Christ, not individuals, but the bride of Christ itself, the church, the gathering, the ecclesia. God tells us that upon every dwelling place, natural family, and upon every assembly, spiritual family, the glory shall be for a defense as a covering. Now follow what I'm talking about. We're talking about a covering. We're talking about the natural family and the spiritual family. God uses a very real force for this protective covering for His people. God has promised covering and protection to His people. He's promised to be a wall of fire all around them. He has promised to give His angels charge over them in times of danger and extreme pressure. God wants to separate or put a difference between His people, even as He put a division between Israel in the days of plague in Exodus chapter 8. What is this canopy? If God's people today are going to have protection and covering in these days, they have to be in the place where God says they are to be. They must be rightly related to the family of God, which is the church. This covering is the church. When people degrade the church and demean the church, they are demeaning the very covering of protection that God intends for us in these great days of plague and dissonance and discord and great evil. The family is a place of covering and protection. The local family, individual families, and the family of God. Now I want you to pay close attention to some examples that God gave us during times of admonition and exhortation in the days of pressure. These are God's warnings. This is seen in the days of flooding. Our day is characterized by the days of Noah. We see a flooding of filth across the land. Thousands of people are being swept away in the tides and undercurrents of it all. Do away with the police. Let evil reign. Evil takes place on our streets, and the evil responds. Those who kill and murder and loot and destroy are as much of a thug as the man, the policeman, who took the life of Mr. Floyd. Evil does not bring about good, and there's no excuse for evil. There's no excuse for destroying property. There's no excuse for taking the life of another human being. But we live in times where the enemy is seeking whom he may devour. Times of great pressure and great evil. These may well be the last days. Satan, knowing that his days are numbered, is looking for one great and final harvest. The tares, according to Matthew 13, are coming to full fruit. The Bible says, if you read Matthew 13, that the tares are gathered first, taken into the barn, and burned before the great gathering of the wheat. In the days of Noah, however, God warned His people of coming desolation. And the people of God responded. How? By faith, and prepared a vessel that would be their ark of safety. Today, that ark of safety is the church. Hebrews 11:7. By faith, Noah, when warned about things not yet seen, in holy fear built an ark to save his family. By his faith, he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. What would have happened had he not obeyed? His family had not obeyed and built the ark. When the floods came, there would have been no covenant ark for them to hide in. Outside was the flood and death. Inside that ark was peace, dryness, and safety. This day and time in which we live, the safety we're going to find is in the ark of covenant. And that ark today in Christ is His bride, is the church, local and international. It was the only safe place for the family to be. All outside were washed away when the floods came. What a warning. What a warning to the people of God today. It's not enough to be only right in our thinking. We must be right in our placement. We must be right where we're at. This is seen in the day of plagues. Our days are characterized by the days of the Exodus. All of the plagues that came upon the Egyptians as means of judgment are prophetic of plagues that are to come upon the earth in the last days. And they correspond to judgments in the book of Revelation. During the time of plagues in the book of Exodus, God worked a special miracle in behalf of His people. God put a division between His people and Goshen and all of the Egyptians, according to Exodus 8. Verse 22 says, "And I will sever in that day the land of Goshen, in which my people dwell, that no swarm of flies shall be there, to the end thou mayest know that I am the Lord in the midst of the earth. And I will put a division between my people and thy people. Tomorrow shall this be a sign." The word division is the Hebrew word perduth. It means redemption or to redeem. In the Hebrew, redemption is the important thing. God has severed us from the world by the redemptive blood of Jesus Christ. We are redeemed. We are set aside. There's an ark for us. And it's the body of Christ. It's our local fellowships and the translocal fellowship as a whole. Moreover, if the Israelites were going to experience the benefit of redemption, they had to be in the place of God's provision. When there were flies in Egypt, there were no flies in Goshen. When there was darkness in Egypt, there was light in Goshen. But if an Israeli had been in Egypt and not in Goshen during the plagues, they would have experienced the plagues, no matter if they were God's chosen people. It is important where you dwell. God did his part by separating Goshen, but the Israelites had to do their part by staying in the place of God's provision, which in that day was Goshen. The name Goshen means drawing near. They had to stay near to the Lord, in the place of the Lord, to experience the provision of God. If an Israelite would have ventured out of Goshen, throwing off his identification with the people of God during the time of plagues, he would in no way be immune to the plagues. He did not have a personal light over him. The light was in Goshen. You see, you and I cannot stand alone. You think your faith is strong by yourself? Let me tell you, friend, in the time of desolation, you will need the body of Christ. We need one another. And in this day in which we live, we need each other more than ever before. The principle is seen dramatically in the last plague, the death of the firstborn. In this plague, God used the picture of the family. Each family that was spared by this plague had to follow strict guidelines laid down by God. To be an Israelite was not enough to spare your firstborn. You had to follow strictly God's instructions. You had to have partaken of the Passover lamb. You had to have the blood sprinkled of the lamb over the doorposts of your home. And you had to stay in the house that night. You had to stay. The blood would not help you if you were outside the house. And the blood of Christ covers the church, my friend. I know he covers us individually, but our protection is in the fellowship. It's in the body of Christ. I heard a great illustration one time. A man said, "Well, yes, you can swim to England. The swimming may be good, but the sharks will eat you alive. You better go in a boat or by plane." In Exodus 12:21, Moses called for all the elders of Israel and said unto them, "Draw out and take you a lamb according to your families, kill the Passover, and you shall take a bunch of hyssop, dip it in the blood that is in the basin, strike the lintel and the two side posts with the blood that is in the basin. And none of you shall go out of the door of his house until the morning. For the Lord will pass through to smite the Egyptians, and when he sees the blood upon the lintel and the two side posts, the Lord will pass over the door and will not suffer the destroyer to come into your house or houses to smite you." Wow, this has great meaning. God didn't bring the death, but the angel did. But when the blood was seen, God says, "I'll be your canopy." Today, the church is our canopy. The fellowship of the believers is our canopy. Don't make excuses to miss fellowship in the house of God. For in the fellowship of the church, local and translocal, you find safety, you find protection, you find direction, you find instruction in the ways of God. We need one another. Because of our laziness and contempt of the thing of authority, we sometimes despise coming to a fellowship. But I'm telling you, without the fellowship of the house of God, we are open game to the enemy. God's promise to the Israelites, they followed his admonition, was he himself would be their canopy. But without them staying and listening to his admonition, there was no protection. This is also seen in the days of shaking. I think it's obvious to all of us that we're living in days when the stronghold of man and the walls of man's strength are crumbling right before our eyes. It is a day when the people of God are possessing their inheritance as well. It was during this period in history that God gives us another picture of salvation and deliverance in connection with the family. This is the preservation of Rahab's family. You remember the story? You remember it well. When the spies came to search out the land, Rahab saw that God was with them, and she requested in Joshua 2 that they save her family because she helped them. And they told her there were certain conditions. She would stay inside her home, and she was to put a scarlet thread outside the balcony. And they said that when we come, if you were there and the scarlet thread is seen, if anything happens to you, your blood is on our hands. But if you don't do as we say, then the blood is on yours. And can you imagine that day when it happened, that this last condition had been met, that when she gathered her household in a time of judgment, that if they were to experience the protection and provision that God laid out, they would have to remain inside the door of the house and identify with the family which was distinguished by the scarlet thread. If they chose to go outside, it didn't matter how close they were naturally related to Rahab. Their blood would be upon their own heads. No protection, no provision would be guaranteed. Don't go outside in this day which we see Satan moving so strongly. Don't go outside today, my friend. Don't be found outside the fellowship of believers. Don't be found outside the Ark of the Covenant today, which is the body of Christ, which is the church. Don't be found alone. There's evil on every hand. You turn on the television, all you see is corruption and division, hatred. We have such a great lack of leadership. Our leaders are bowing to those on the far extremes of everything. They're afraid. They're acting as cowards. No one will stand up for what is right. But God says if you will listen to Him, He will be our protection. The Ark of Noah was an ark of salvation. Noah and his family, the Ark of Moses, preserved a godly remnant in a time when other babies were being martyred and experiencing death. The same waters that brought death to many brought life to others. The difference was the ark. You see, the third ark in the Bible is a beautiful picture of Christ and the church. It's the Ark of the Covenant. This ark portrays the head of the body, Christ, as the mercy seat covering of the box or body of the ark. Over the whole thing are the ark outstretched wings of the two cherubs. And this ark, too, is the message of preservation. One picture of preservation is seen in connection with a golden pot of manna that was kept inside in the ark, Exodus 16:33. Moses said unto Aaron, take a pot, put an omer full of manna therein, lay it before the Lord to be kept for your generations. It's interesting to note that when manna was first given, they would eat it all, because anything that was not left eaten would gather worms and decay. But this, in the Ark of the Covenant, was preserved. It was preserved for year after year after year. As long as the manna was in the ark, it was able to be eaten, as David showed when he brought his men in that night. But the manna placed under the shelter of the wings, under the blood-stained mercy seat, in the Ark of the Covenant's provision, never saw corruption, never saw worms, never bred decay. It was in the right place, and it experienced preservation. God is showing us that in our day, a day of judgment, a day of wickedness, a day of perversion, and a day of deception, that He has provided a place of covering and protection. When you and I submit to God's authority in our lives through humility and the acceptance of His provision, we will be covered and protected from the fiery darts of the enemy. We'll not be deceived in the days of moral, religious, political, and natural upheaval. But if we choose through pride and stubbornness to reject the message of provision of our God and to step out from under the canopy of God in these days because of our rebellion, out from under the canopy of the church, our blood will be upon our own hearts and heads. God promises no protection outside His church. Christ made it clear to Satan that to expect protection when we're not in the place of protection is presumptive. Jesus knew it would be tempting God to claim a promise of Scripture without meeting the conditions of that Scripture. Matthew 4, 5. The devil took him up into the holy city, set him on the pinnacle of the temple, said unto him, If thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down. For it is written, He shall give His angels charge concerning thee. And in their hands shall they bear thee up, lest any time when you dash thy foot against a stone. Jesus said unto him, It is written again, Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Psalms 34, 7, The angel of the Lord encampeth around about them that fear Him, and He delivers them. I'm telling you, man has surrounded the church. The evil would pull it down. Satan would give you a lie. Your protection is in the fellowship of the church. To demean the church is to demean the very protection that brings you eternal life. To demean the necessity of the fellowship is to destroy your protection and to take you and your family outside of it. Don't play games with your eternal soul. It's important, my friend. The church is vital. We need the church more desperately today than probably any other time in our lives. He said, He loves us. He said, Call unto me and I will answer you. And I will show you great and mighty things that you do not know. We do err that we know not the word of God. The whole Bible talks of redemption. And that redemption through the New Testament leads us to Christ, which brings a canopy, the ecclesia, the body of Christ, which is the eternal church. God bless you is my prayer. May you find peace and strength. And may you be found this weekend in a fellowship of believers. For there you have great protection. God bless you.
Mighty God, my rock, my healer. Precious Lord, my soul redeemer. In all the world, there's nothing sweeter than the name.